just want to say on behalf of our music ministry here, I'm so grateful for our choir members and some of their spouses who stepped up to give you some music for the Christmas season. There are many churches that are moving on as normal. There are some who have canceled services altogether, and I'm just so grateful we were able to share that music with you. We will be ringing on Christmas Eve and next week and the first week of January. It's not too late. We will be rehearsing after service today. If you want to commit for two more weeks, we'd love to have you join us. So thank you so much to my ringers.
Very helpful. There's 20 stairs to come down. Gave me a chance to catch my breath. Oh, good morning, family. I don't know how many of you are doing the Advent wreath at home, but I hope that you have been, or in some way celebrating this expectation time, where we are looking forward to Christ entering as a human being once again. It's something that we do every year, and every year it gets more precious to me, and I hope that it does for you as well. I have been asked a couple of times already this morning, where are the poinsettias? And I would just like to tell you that if you have seen them on a Sunday before Christmas Eve, that means that that Sunday is within a day or two. They are fragile plants, of course, and so they will be here on Christmas Eve, having been delivered on the 23rd. So when you're here on Christmas Eve, if you are getting a poinsettia to take home, that's when you'll be able to get it. Please, if you will, pay special attention to the announcements in the bulletin. There are the 24 days of giving, and we're asking that you collect those items that are on the list. If you haven't received the list, look in one of your announcements from prior weeks. It was there. Christmas Eve service will be on Thursday at 6:30, and Pastor David will be here. And I know we all look forward to seeing him and bombarding him with questions about Elijah. He will probably have a couple of recent photographs. There are candy canes over here on that last pew that the ushers usually sit at, and that's a gift from Pat Sprague. Please feel free to take one or two. The last thing that I wanted to mention is in regards to the drive-by baby shower. If you were there, you got a game card of predictions, and we told everyone that there will be a valuable prize for the person who gets the closest answers. The last date of guessing as far as the birth was December the 6th, which was Megan's due date. So we counted that one for that particular person. Then there was the eye color and the hair color, and you saw those in the pictures. Then there were the other specific things, like how long he or she, there was another one, was, and how much he or she weighed. And we do have a winner. This person had, by far, the most answers that were close without going over the actual retail. Oh, wait a minute. That's the Price is Right. Sorry. But our winner of a $60 gift card to any of the Darden restaurants in the area is June Thomas. Congratulations, June, and thanks, everyone, for all you've been doing for the pastors and their family. One other and last thing that I will mention is that you would have received in an email a link to take you to a place to sign up and to prepare or provide a meal for the Killingsworth family. One of the options is to hire Mark from the Picnic Project to cook a meal. And if you know, restaurants are really taking a beating these days. even here in Florida, where things are a little bit more easygoing. But Meals by Mark for $25 is a really good option. And since he is so ministry-minded and does so much for the community that we serve, I would just suggest that maybe you give that an idea or give that a look. But we're going to be providing meals several times during the week for the Killingsworth through the next month or so. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. Good morning, church. It is great to be with you all. I am Ryan Frack, the Director of Church Relations at the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. And as we continue our time of worship, whether you are here in person or joining us online, I invite you now to join me in a time of prayer as we pray for illumination for the reading of God's Word. Oh God, in all that we are going through, whether it is personal or as a church, as a nation, or as a global community, God, we are grateful for this time of waiting, this time where we stop and prepare our hearts for this joyous occasion that we look forward to, the coming of Christ into the world, the greatest gift that was ever given. Oh God, as we gather today once again, we are grateful for so many things. We thank you for this community. And we know that whether we gather in person or online, whether we stay in touch by sharing words in person or sending texts or whatever we are doing, we know that this community is indeed a gift. And God, as we hear your word read and proclaimed this morning, we ask that you would show us something different. Prepare our hearts, illumine our minds by what we hear read and proclaimed today. We pray this in all things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading is from Psalm 85. I'll be reading verses 1 and 2 and 8 through 13. Psalm 85, for the director of music of the sons of Korah, a psalm. You showed favor to your land, O Lord. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered all their sins. I will listen to what God the Lord will say. He promises peace to his people, his saints, but let them not return to folly. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps. The word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Oh, and before we do that, we will do the prayers of the people, as you all are accustomed to, whether in person or online. And after I lift up each individual group, I invite you to say the name of an individual or a group or whoever might be pertaining to that, or simply lift that up privately. And then when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you will repeat here our prayer. Let us go to God in prayer. God, we are grateful that throughout creation, you have not left us alone. That is intimately something that we are aware of this time of year during Advent, but it is true all times. And God, we know that you don't want us to go through the things that we go through in our lives and in our world by ourselves. You want to know, you want to hear from us. And so God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to lift up both joys, occasions of celebration, as well as those fear and trepidation, those moments where we cry out for your guidance. And so we come as a community together, joining together, lifting up specific requests in our hearts and in our lives. God, we take a moment to lift up our own Sanford community, for those here amongst us who are in need of your prayer, as well as those for whom we have a reason to celebrate. And so we take a moment now to lift up those in our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we take time to lift up all of those members of the armed forces, those that are serving both here and abroad, those for whom holiday times might be spent further away from family and loved ones. God, so we lift up those service members and their families now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Oh God, we take time to lift up our leaders, both on a community level as well as state, national, and world level, those that are charged with guiding us. We take a moment now to lift them up. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Oh God, we take time now, as you have reminded us, that we don't only pray for those with whom we agree, but even those with whom we might disagree and struggle. So God, we lift up our enemies, as you have called us to do. So we take time to do that now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Oh God, for all of those, whether in our community or with whom we are connected, who are sick, who are in hospitals, who are struggling, as well as those who are homebound, and those especially for whom this is an even more isolating time when we are keeping distance and separated. And so we pray for those who are sick and homebound now.
Margaret Bear.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And God, we bring all of these requests to you, these moments of celebration, and we lift them up to you knowing that you hear them, that no cry from us goes unheard. And God, we take time now to lift up the prayer that your Son taught us, praying together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
How could it be, this baby in my arms, sleeping now so peacefully? The Son of God, the angel said, how could it be? Lord, I know he is not my own, not of my flesh and not of my bone. Still, Father, let this baby be the son of my love. Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a man be father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? He looks so small, his hands and face so fair. And when he cries, the sun just seems to disappear. But when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a man be father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? How could it be, this baby in my arms, sleeping now so peacefully? The Son of God, the angel said, how could it be? How could it be?
That was so beautiful, Scott. Thank you. The New Testament lesson.
lesson is from the Gospel of Matthew,
chapter 1. I'll be reading verses 18 through 25. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. The word of God for the people of God. Amen.
Let us pray. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, before we begin, I have a confession to share with you all. Normally, and maybe you line up with this statement, normally I am somebody who does not like to mix my holiday seasons. The way it's supposed to work is Lent happens, and then Eastertide. Halloween happens, and then All Saints Day, and then Thanksgiving, and then Advent, and then Christmas. That is how it's supposed to work, right? Y'all with me so far? I'll be completely candid. This year, and you all have heard a lot, I think Pastor Amy last week called it the Adventist Advent, which is awesome. This year, that has gone out the window for me. With all of the stress and the anxiety and the struggle that has come through 2020, my view on the holidays is completely different. It has really changed from what it was. So I will share with you all, just as a moment of hopefully solidarity, for those of you all that are here in person or those online, for anybody who felt the urge to string up your Christmas lights in August, I get it, y'all. And you can keep it up as long as you want. For anybody who began taking holiday photos in September, I'm with you. And if there's anybody here who was blaring Christmas music before Halloween, I say you have chosen the better way. So let's just put that out there. There seems to be this collective desire for the anticipation and the hope that Christmas brings, isn't there? Especially this year. And it is true not only in the church, but also in the world. And really, friends, Advent is tailor-made to meet that desire that we have. You all have heard a lot about what Advent means, this season of waiting, of the coming of Christ. And it really is a time when we are waiting in the darkness, but we are almost to Christmas, right? We are now in single digits. For anybody who does the Advent countdown, my kids love that. We are in single digits, friends. We're almost there, and yet we take time to slow down and take in the sights on this final leg of our journey. And what I love about Advent is this is not just waiting for waiting's sake. There is an end in sight. Advent is a time when we celebrate with lights, and we have carols, and we have food, and we have traditions. We normally have company, but we adapt this year. So as we look toward the promised coming of Jesus Christ, we lift up specific themes of the Advent season. And I know with the Advent wreath, as Sue alluded to, I know my family loves that, and our kids are really getting into it. With the Advent wreath, as well as the Honest Advent series that y'all are doing here in church, You have discussed quite a few themes so far. You've done hope, vulnerability. You've done peace, identity, joy, and embodiment. And these themes surely shine light to us in the midst of our darkness. Now, friends, I am very aware that as I stand before you this morning, I am following a pretty tough act. You see, Pastor Amy is beyond being a wonderful preacher and person that she is, as she was sharing about the themes of joy and embodiment, she was able to proclaim to you all the good news of a baby born here in Sanford Community. Right? Y'all with me? You following? And then she left, and we are still waiting. This is still a time of waiting. And I am very aware that unless baby Elijah has learned to speak or to walk from last Sunday to this Sunday, I got nothing on that announcement. So whatever your bar that was set last week for you, let's lower it a little bit, because I am very aware of who I am following. But nonetheless, friends, today's theme focuses on love. And for most of us, when this topic comes up, we might think about a significant other or our spouse or our kids. We might think of butterflies in our stomach or something romantic. And for that reason, love is not really something that our culture tends to focus on a lot, at least not until February, and then that's all we talk about. But this Sunday, and very rightfully so, we are focusing and celebrating on love. And to help focus our minds on this theme, we read a very familiar story, friends, from the Gospel of Matthew. We hear of the birth of Jesus, and really, we kind of do so through Joseph's eyes. So as a bit of a recap, we read of an engaged couple, Joseph and Mary. And I do want to say that while they were engaged, that's kind of a misnomer. You see, they were engaged, but not in the way that we currently understand engagement. So a bit of context for you all. Mary and Joseph were actually contractually obligated to one another. So they had gone through quite a bit of formalities together. So they were married by almost all intents and purposes. So they hadn't lived together. They hadn't consummated the marriage. But they were married. So when we talk about an engaged couple, they were a married couple. So with that little bit of background, we hear then that Joseph finds out that his beloved was pregnant and he was not the father. And he assumed what others might have, that she had been unfaithful. And so now, in this story, Joseph has a choice to make. And the scripture tells us that Joseph was a righteous man. He followed the law. He was upright in the eyes of the law. And so by law, Joseph was entitled to bring that news before the public and have Mary stoned to death. Or at the very least, he would seek to shame her for her acts. That's what the law would have allowed. But then the next sentence describes Joseph. There's a lot of ping-ponging back and forth, so I'll just put this out there for y'all. The next sentence tells us that Joseph is a man of great character when he says that Joseph didn't want to humiliate Mary. And so instead, he opted to divorce her quietly. So instead of seeking vindication, he just wanted for them to move on. So Joseph was going to do what he thought was the loving thing, and that was to not subject Mary to any embarrassment or even to any physical pain. Now, a disclaimer to this story is that we know this was told pretty much from Joseph's perspective. There are two sides to this story, as is often the case in Scripture, and yet we don't hear much at all from Mary on this particular situation. And we are left simply to imagine her vulnerability and anxiety, which, spoiler alert, was pretty high. Are y'all with me so far? But for the sake of cultural significance, I do think we must consider what Joseph had felt. Immediately through his eyes, we see this pregnancy as less of a joy-filled blessing and more of a very real cause for concern and doubt. So Joseph has some strong feelings about what happens to Mary, and then he waits uncomfortably, I'm sure, for this thing to be resolved. So I want you to set that imagery aside for a second. Now, I've gotten to know many of you all here in the church. Not only does my family attend this church, but I've gotten to know many of you all through my work at the children's home, your neighbor right across Lake Monroe. And I'll tell you that at the children's home, uncomfortable waiting is sort of a constant for us. That's something we are used to and have been since we've been founded. We serve children who have experienced a variety of traumatic events, from abuse and neglect to abandonment, family substance use, and broken trust. And while we seek to get a long-term resolution for them, to watch them spread their wings and fly and make a new chapter for them, we often end up waiting in the uncomfortable in-between. I think of children we serve like Taylor, who was removed from his home at an early age because of abuse and neglect that he, or abuse he had experienced, as well as substance use that had happened in his family. Now, Taylor actually went on to be adopted, but unfortunately found his way to the children's home just a few short years later. And for Taylor, I'll tell y'all, friends, that he struggled with shame from the things that he had experienced. He regularly was asking his therapist and his staff if he would ever be able to overcome the things that had happened to him, if people would ever know him by more than just the things that he had experienced in his life. And I'll tell you that, unfortunately, at the children's home, stories like Taylor's are not uncommon. We see these children that we serve very seriously grappling with issues of self-worth and value, of whether or not they are worthy of being loved. And I will tell you that, like Mary, many of the children that we served have experienced struggles in their peripheral relationships due to the things that have been thrust upon them in their lives. And at the very least, many of their own self-perceptions are keeping them from embracing their identities as beloved children of God. So you want to talk about the theme of love today? This concept of placing the needs of another greater than your own, or having somebody do that for you. The idea of holding a deep and abiding affection for someone else and having them hold that for you. That theme is really a foreign concept for many of our kids. Heck, for many of them, they struggle to love themselves and wonder how they could ever be worthy of that love as well. The way it often works is they experienced great tragedy. Others have treated them differently because of it. And they, in turn, end up embracing the identity of somebody who is on the outside of things. Now, clearly, I speak from a perspective of somebody working at the children's home. But you all know this issue is not something that is limited to those in the children's home. It's not limited to those in foster care. It's not even limited to children. As I speak to you today, I'm sure there are folks in here who have done something from which you feel like your reputation might never be able to bounce back. Or maybe your marriage has hit a rough patch and you're wondering the effects it might have on your friendships. Or maybe you let somebody down because you weren't able to deliver on something the way that you had hoped for. Friends, you all know what it is like to see this idea of love as nothing more than an unattainable dream. Something that will never find you worthy. You know, the problem tends to be, friends, that our very existence in this world seems to be a participation in a system that bases our worth on what we can give, on what we can contribute to somebody else. That's the problem when we talk about love in the church, is that in society we so often get love wrong, don't we? We don't know how to talk about it well. The things that we do and the things that we don't do, the impact that we make, all of these are things that endear other people to us or not, or they repel other people. Even the most well-meaning of us can fall back into the worldly patterns of tit for tat, of I give and then you give, and back and forth. We buy into this idea that my care for you is dependent upon your care or your actions or your benefits toward me. And in the midst of it, our value hangs in the balance. See, friends, this is our predicament in the in-between as we talk about love, this God-given gift. So if we can, I want to return back to Matthew, our scripture this morning. Matthew then returns and kind of picks up on a dream that Joseph has right after this news of Mary being pregnant is brought to light to him. So I'm going to paraphrase. This is in verse 20. So in this dream then, I won't paraphrase. I'll just tell you what happens. The angel tells Joseph in a dream to not worry, to take Mary in marriage without any fear of impropriety, of doing anything wrong. And so immediately you can feel this great burden that he had being lifted. And so Joseph did exactly what the angel said. He and Mary got married. She had the child. They went on to live their lives as a proper family. So this dream that Joseph had, in which he encounters an angel, this dream was quite powerful, friends, as dreams often are. Taylor Burton Edwards, a commentator, writes about the neuroscience of dreaming. What he says is that during a dream, our mind consolidates all of these random thoughts into greater coherence as we continue on. And so in this way, a dream actually allows us to connect things that in regular time might not be connected. In our dreams, we're able to actually see possibilities revealed that might never before have existed. It's kind of a cool thing to think about, right? When you conceptualize dreams, limits and expectations and conventions really have no hold on the connections that can be made. So that is why in our dreams, just to give you a little information, the unexpected and often out of place can thrive. That's also why you can wake up having a crazy dream that seems to make no sense, because they connect things that aren't often connected. So in Joseph's dream, the angel connects the dots in ways that Joseph couldn't have fathomed. He tells Joseph, Mary's pregnancy really was not the result of an affair. She was telling you the truth. And the God that called them to this obscure, scandalous task is big enough to see them through it. Now, for many of us, we would read this story as proof of Mary's love and faithfulness towards Joseph, and that certainly is the case. For others of us, we would read this story as Joseph's love that helps him to see through his own fears, to push through his own insecurities, and actually believe and trust his beloved, and that is certainly the case as well. But you know, I think the deeper truth that Matthew is revealing to us really does have to do with the birth of Jesus Christ himself. See, Matthew wants us to understand God loves us and all of creation so much that God is giving of God's self to be born, God with us. And Mary and Joseph are playing a vital role in this love act to the world. This dream that Joseph had really opened him up to a divine love that was not of Joseph's making. He had nothing to do with it, but he got to play a part in it. See, friends, the thing about Advent is we wait, but we don't wait in vain. Praise God. Not only do we hold tight for the fulfillment of God's promises, but we also join in with all of creation in the revealing of those promises right now in our time. We get to see glimpses of that. That's why we lift up the image of light, because it's held in such stark contrast to the dark around us. And the more light we have, the greater our hearts and our minds are illumined. So I have a question for you all. What difference has God with us made in your life? What if during this Advent season, we're called to a love that willingly holds us open to the possibility that God might be doing more in and through somebody else than we could ever imagine. What if we might be open to those possibilities and to have those dots connected for us? With that, I want to return to Taylor, the young man at the children's home who has been mired by shame. We found that in the years he was in our care, Taylor got really involved in our program, particularly through our recreation department and the newly formed running club. Taylor found that not only did he develop a love of running, he was really good at it. He started bringing home medals, which made him popular amongst his peers. Taylor also got involved in our chapel program. He was regularly serving as an acolyte, as a worship leader, and he became quite the musician, learning to sing and to play drums and to play guitar. And if that wasn't enough, the thing that really set Taylor apart had nothing to do with his abilities. But the thing that his staff and his therapist were regularly talking about was the fact that Taylor took time to pour into the lives of others. Unprompted, he was scheduling his own time to mentor other kids who wanted to become runners themselves, who wanted to learn the form of the sport. He also took time to give lessons to those who wanted to learn to become their own singer and musician. And see, what Taylor found, this young man who was struggling on the dark road of shame, was that God wanted to use him to make a difference in the lives of those around him. God loves him and all of us that much. And friends, at the children's home, that really sums up our call to ministry, to communicate deep love and value and worth in the midst of darkness. And I think the same is true here at First Methodist Sanford. The children we serve are told that no matter where their journey has taken them, no matter the depths of their experiences or where they've come from, God loves them. Their past does not define them because their identity is in Christ, God with us. And because God has loved them, they too can give love to others, even in the waiting. So on behalf of your children's home, and at this time we'll bring our screen down, I just want to thank you all for your support. The children's home is not something new to First Sanford, I'm really proud to say. You all have a long and rich tradition of supporting the children's home in many ways, through your financial support, through your gift cards I know were just brought over for volunteering when we're able to get back to that again, and in-kind donations. You all do so much to support the children and families we serve, and without your support, we wouldn't be able to do what we do. So I want to ask you all, if you can, to continue praying for us and our children. Once it's safe to do so, we can't wait to have folks back on campus. We will have, I know we normally have our day on campus event in the spring. This year it's going to be virtual, so everybody can come. And for those of you all that want to check us out on our website, you can visit www.fumch.org. If you feel moved to give, you can text the word SPARK to 50155 or give on our website. But I have a really special announcement, and I actually teased this when I was here back in March, when I was talking to you all about our day on campus event that was supposed to happen before before the dumpster fire of 2020 came to be. And I had shared with you all that every year we name some award winners for those that go above and beyond in their support of the children's home. And it is really exciting that actually Pastor Megan and David were named as our pastors of the year for 2019. And so I was here just a couple weeks ago. Baby Elijah is in this picture, but in utero. And so they got to celebrate it. And I didn't think about this. I'm showing you a picture of a clear award. So we'll hopefully get this up on the social media. You can see it. But they're holding an award which lifts up just the many ways that under their leadership, this church has continued in this rich tradition. But I would be remiss to tell you, and Pastor Megan and David were very firm in this, that I let you all know this is a church award. That they wouldn't get this award without you all and the constant commitment you have, not only to serving the children's home in the ways that you do, but to being committed to mission in the way that you are. And so on behalf of the children's home and on behalf of Pastor Megan and David, thank you for making this possible, for being a church that lifts up the light of children who are in need. So if you will, just give yourselves a round of applause for being a church committed to children. So friends, during this season of Advent, as we reflect on the promised light of Christ coming into the world, I want to ask, where do you all right now see glimpses of love in the world? Where might God be calling you to be an active part of that love work? And so friends, we lift this up in hope and anticipation of the coming Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now as we depart, I invite you all to stand as you feel led and receive this benediction.
We have a new member in the front. Right?
Oh, before we go. So we have a new member in the front. I never like to call folks out unless they know it's coming. So do you want to share a little bit about your little one? Amen. Baby Madeline. Lift it up. Praise God. And I don't know if this hits different for y'all, but as we're speaking about the birth of a little one and hearing the little cries, it hits a little bit different, doesn't it? Praise God, we have hope even in the midst of the darkness. Welcome, little one. Congratulations to you all. What a wonderful gift. Amen. So as you all now remain standing, receive this benediction. In this time of waiting, may you not grow weary from anticipation. May you look for love at every opportunity. And may God empower you to work for a love that not only stops harm from happening, but also truly seeks out good in all that you encounter. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, go in peace and go in love.